Again, I want to welcome everyone to Am Israel Messianic Synagogue. Okay, turn to Devarim or Deuteronomy chapter 15. How many of you heard the radio program last week? I got a surprise from a certain caller that calls in a lot. Kind of took me a little bit by surprise. And Deuteronomy 15:19 is where we're going. That seemed to, you know, he kind of helps us a little bit with certain others, we won't call no names, that we have some challenges with from time to time. And but what really surprised me was that, it caught me off guard, was he seemed to think that Yeshua never died when he went into the tomb. He was alive the whole time when he took him. Now, I'm going to deal with that today. Amen. I don't believe there's nobody here that believes that. I hope there's not, but if you do, we're going to deal with that today, okay? Amen? And we're going to deal, since this is the ending of Pesach, unleavened bread and first fruits, and we're counting Omer for 50 days until Shavuot or Pentecost. Okay. Deuteronomy, Devarim, chapter 15 and verse 19. 15 and 19. You shall consecrate to Yod-Vav-Heh, the Lord your God, all the firstborn males that are born of your herd and of your flock. And you shall not work with the firstborn of your herd, nor shear the firstborn of your flock. There to be set aside. You and your household shall eat it every year before Yod-Vav-Heh, the Lord your God, in the place where which he chooses. Not the place which we would have chosen if we were back then, but the place that he chose. But if it has any defect, such as lameness or blindness or any serious defect, you shall not sacrifice it to Yod-Vav-Heh, the Lord your God. It had to be spotless. It had to be sinless, so to speak, if we want to use that terminology. It had to be a pure lamb. And we know that Yeshua was that lamb. But also Yeshua expects his bride, as him being the bridegroom, the lamb, to be without spot, wrinkle, or blemish too. Oh my. You didn't know that applied to us, huh? It does. So we need to think about that, okay? You shall eat it within your gates, the unclean and the clean alike may eat it as a gazelle or a deer. Only you shall not eat its blood. You are to pour it out on the ground like water because the life is in the blood. The blood is very important. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. And the blood of bulls and goats were never meant to atone for mankind's sins. They were only a temporary covering until the Lamb of God, Yeshua, Jesus the Messiah, would come one day, and he has come to fulfill the spring feast we'll talk about as we go through this today. And he was the spotless lamb. He was the pure blood that was without sin, and it could atone forever for mankind's sin. Thank God. Hallelujah. Chapter 16 and verse 1. Observe. Observe means not to look out there, oh, I'm observing the stars, I'm observing Passover, that looks good, I like those Jewish people doing that over there. Let's observe them. Is that what it means? No. It means to do it, to keep it. And we have to understand we got the ideal, and this is constantly, it's amazing, a lot of people are learning the truth, hallelujah, but there's a lot that still don't know it, that these are not the feast of the Jews. These are Yod-Vav-Heh, the Lord Adonai's feast for all his people, Jew and Gentile alike. It's just that he gave them the oracles. He gave them these and taught them to them so that they would teach the rest of the nations the way. He is the way. Yeshua is the way, the Derek, the truth, the Emet, and the life, Kai. Derek, Emet, Kai, the way, the truth, and the life. That is their job. That's my job. That's your job when you come to a knowledge of the truth and you learn what it's all about, to share the good news, to go out and to win the lost. The good news is that Yeshua is the Lamb of God who died for the forgiveness of the sins of the whole world, Jew and Gentile alike, the one you made in Messiah. Amen? Observe the month of Abib. The month of Abib is when the barley harvest, the grain heads are ready. The month of Aviv, and celebrate the Pesach, the Passover, to Yod-Vav-Heh, the Lord your God. For in the month of Aviv, the Lord Yod-Vav-Heh, your Elohim, brought you out of Egypt by night. He's saying that in this month, which will be the beginning of months for you in another part of the scripture, it's his calendar. It's not the Gregorian calendar. When we deal with God's calendar, we need to learn how to overlay it onto the Gregorian calendar, which we function and operate from, so we can know the difference. Because if you're trying to figure out God's plan for you based solely on the Gregorian calendar, you're going to be messed up really bad. If you think we're having a little trouble when we know the truth about it, and you're trying to deal it from the Gregorian calendar, which is what seems that most of the world is, you got a lot of problems. You're really going to be messed up. You're never going to understand what God's talking about. So it's important, because he brought them out that night from the land of Mitzrayim, Egypt, spiritual bondage and slavery. When Messiah died for us, he brought us out through his blood. If we accept the atoning sacrifice, he brought us out of the spiritual bondage of sin that's in our lives to set us free. Amen. And this is the picture. And you shall sacrifice the Passover to Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the Lord your God, from the flock and the herd in the place where Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the Lord, where you choose. Is that what it says? No, it doesn't. It says where he chooses to establish his name. It's not about us establishing our congregation's name in a certain place in Navarre and doing our worship the way we want to worship. It's about us obeying him, doing things his the way he wants us to do it, amen? Where he is placed, he places his name in us when we come to him by faith and trust in him. You shall not eat leavened bread with it. Leavened bread is that nice bread we always have most of the year that these ladies are learning to be experts on. Oh, man, can't wait till fast break this evening, huh? But we're not to eat that because it's a picture and type of sin. That's why we go in this feast to remove the leaven before the Pesach offering is slain and the leavened bread starts. It's a picture and type as we physically remove leaven from our homes. Is that if you miss this point, then you miss the whole thing. If you're removing leaven from your homes and you're not looking at what's going on in your life, if there's any sin in your life that you need to ask God to forgive you of and to remove from your life, then you've missed the whole point. You might as well not remove any leaven from your house. Because I think there's a scripture Paul talked about how that we're to keep the feast, not with the old leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the new unleavened bread of sincerity and truth, the Word of God. Amen. You shall not eat leavened bread with it. 7 days you shall eat it with unleavened bread, the bread of affliction. Why is it called the bread of affliction? Has anybody eat and been doing what you're supposed to be doing? Man, you're trying to find all kinds of stuff that's okay to put on that to keep you from being afflicted when you eat it, right? Because it's dry in your mouth and it makes your mouth go dry and it's like, is it like cardboard? Now, y'all know I'm telling the truth, right? Now, some of you, maybe you've gotten so good at it, you really have learned to like it, and that's great. But reality is it's a bread of affliction because they were leaving in haste. They had been afflicted. They didn't have time to let it rise, and they had to get on with the program that God had set in order for them. So the bread of affliction for you came out of the land of Egypt in haste in order that you may remember all the days of your life, the day when you came out of the land of Egypt. So why, here's a good point number one is why we still got, see Messiah, when he ate the last Passover Seder, it was not a new turned in communion and wine deal. That's a little header they put in your Bible to make you think they changed the Passover to a new deal. No, God said, and he said back here where we're at now, this was forever. For everyone who is in covenant with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Jew and Gentile alike, that you're doing it. Actually, do you understand that after the first Passover, they were doing it as a memorial, even till Messiah came? It didn't just start as a memorial. It was a memorial till he came. And then he came and he fulfilled it. And then he told us again to still continue to keep it as a memorial. As a memorial so we would remember that his body was broken for our sins. His blood was shed for our redemption. And so we're to do this as a memorial, a remembrance of he's the one that delivered us from Mitzrayim, from spiritual, sinful wickedness that we had fallen into because of our father Adam and Hava, and all the way back to the garden. There's a memorial that he is our redeemer. He is our deliverer. He is the one who has set us free. Amen? That's why it's important that we keep it this way. And if we place Easter in place of it and all kinds of other things, and we hunt Easter eggs and bunny rabbits and all that, then Satan has blinded us. He's sidetracked us. And let me say this in all honesty, because I know people are going to be listening to this tape. If you're doing that, it's okay. We know you're doing, you know, we've all done it ourselves. I bet you 99% of the people here has done it when we were in our ignorance, without the understanding that God has for us. But we're in the days of restoration, and God's revealing His truth to us. All around the globe, there's a mighty move of God, and truth is being revealed to our brothers and sisters in the church. Truth's being revealed to our brothers and sisters in the synagogue who have not seen their Messiah because they've been blinded in part to that, and they're coming to faith to Him. There's a restoration taking place worldwide. Hallelujah. So, it's a memorial. That's why we do it, to remember what He has done for us that we could not do for ourselves. There was no amount of keeping the Torah perfectly, keeping the law perfectly. You could not do it good enough to get that atoning, redemptive blood that Messiah shed to save us, to redeem us from our sins. For 7 days no leaven shall be seen with you in all your territory, and none of the flesh which you sacrifice on the evening of the first day shall remain overnight until morning. You are not allowed to sacrifice, listen to this, because this is happening today within some of the messianic groups who have been misled. You got to understand something. Satan doesn't just choose certain ones to pick on to deceive. He's after everybody. He hates mankind. And if truth starts coming forth, he's heading in that direction to try to deceive over there the truth and mess it up so he can't get to the rest of the people. So it's happening even in the messianic movement. You are not allowed to sacrifice the Passover in any of your towns which Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh the Lord is giving you. Number one, you wasn't allowed back then when it was actually being sacrificed in any town you wanted to sacrifice it in. But at the place where Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh the Lord your God chooses to establish His name, you shall sacrifice the Passover in the evening at sunset at the time that you came out of Egypt. So He places His name in Jerusalem where the temple is standing. That would be the place it would have to be sacrificed. There is no temple standing today. Messiah came. He died. He rose again. He became that permanent sacrifice. And now when we accept that atoning blood and He forgives of our sins, He puts His Spirit in us and empowers. We are the temple today. Glory to God. That's why we don't need to profane the temple, because He is living in us. And He wants us to be holy. He says, be holy for I am holy. You think He would tell you to be holy if it wasn't possible? He makes you holy through His Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit that's living in you. Amen? So we're to keep this temple, we're to keep this temple as clean as where the Word of God tells us. And we're learning. Some of us are falling short. The reality of it is we're all going to fall short in some ways till Messiah returns or He calls us home. But the point is to learn His ways and walk in them. And there's grace and mercy there in the time of need while we're walking this life out, Amen? And you shall cook and eat it in the place which shall devolve the Lord your God chooses. And in the morning you are returned to your tent. So the point is this. The point is there should be nobody sacrificing lambs. Now, can we have lamb for Passover? Why, certainly. But we're not going to go out there and set an altar up outside here and say we're sacrificing this lamb for Passover. We'd be going totally against Scripture in every way that you can possibly imagine. And there's a lot of groups around doing that. Right in America, I know some of them. They've been misled. Don't fall into that trap. Amen? Because our Passover lamb, according to the Brit Hadashah, the New Covenant, and the Word of God in the Old Testament, has been sacrificed already for us, Yeshua the Messiah. Amen? He's already been sacrificed. 6 days you shall eat unleavened bread, and on the seventh day there shall be a solemn assembly. That was yesterday, the day that I messed up on. To Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the Lord your God, you shall do no work on it. So see, yesterday, hallelujah, Father. And I hope that y'all too, because if you don't, forgive me, you're in trouble too. Because you got to forgive. The Bible teaches us that, right? Amen? Grace. I needed His grace yesterday. And I need y'all's grace too. Amen? Because I didn't mean to mislead you. Amen? You shall count 7 weeks for yourself. Let me go back and read 8 again. 6 days you shall eat unleavened bread, and on the seventh day there shall be a solemn assembly to Yod-Heh-Vav, the Lord your God. You shall do no work on it. You shall count 7 weeks for yourself, and you shall begin to count 7 weeks from the time you begin to put in the sickle to the standing grain. Then you shall celebrate the Feast of Weeks. That's called Pentecost from the Greek terminology, from the Hebrew terminology. It's called Shavuot, 50 days later after the beginning of the counting of the Omer. Now yesterday was the sixth. Let me see if I got that right before I mess up again. I got it written down. Hold on. Trying to go by memory. You know, when you start getting to be 80 years old like I am, your memory gets a little. So anyway. Yes, I was right. Just want to make sure. Yesterday, actually, even though it was the seventh day of unleavened bread, it was the sixth day of the counting of the Omer. So today's the seventh day. All right? So then you shall celebrate the Feast of Weeks, or Shavuot, or Pentecost, to Yod-Heh-Vav, the Lord your God, with a tribute or a freewill offering of your hand, which you shall give, just as Yod-Heh-Vav, the Lord blesses you. So another thing, too, that we don't talk and have not talked a lot about is because of so many of the churches and synagogues always pushing for money, is that these feasts are a day when you're supposed to bring special offerings. Did you know that? There's the tzedakah box over there. We should remember that. We should remember that God wants us. He actually tells us not to come to the feast empty-handed. We're to bring and present offerings, and you have to do offerings. We're not sacrificing animals today, so you can bring some food if you want to, or put some money in the whatever you got to do, you know, whatever God leads you to do. You're not supposed to come empty-handed. That's between you and Him, but you're not supposed to come empty-handed. All right? Hallelujah. Let me get back to where I was at. Okay, verse 11, and you shall rejoice before Yod-Heh-Vav, the Lord your God, and you and your son and your daughter and your male and female servants and the Levite who is in your town and the stranger, those visiting you from somewhere else, and the orphan and the widow who are in your midst in the place where Yod-Heh-Vav, the Lord your God, chooses to establish his name. And in that case, today he's in us and we're here, so he's this is the area for this community, okay? And you shall remember that you were a slave in Egypt. We shall remember that we were a slave to sin. And you shall be careful to observe these statutes. You shall celebrate the Feast of Booths 7 days after you have gathered in from your threshing floor and your wine vat. And you shall rejoice in your feast, and your son and your daughter and your male and female servants and the Levite and the stranger and the orphan and the widow who are in your town. 7 days you shall celebrate a feast to Yod-Heh-Vav, the Lord your God, in the place which Yod-Heh-Vav chooses, because Yod-Heh-Vav, the Lord your Elohim, your God, will bless you in all your produce and in all the work of your hands, so that you will be altogether joyful. He wants to bless us, and he will bless us if we'll do things his way, not our way. We want to dictate to him, and we want his blessings, but we want to tell him how we want to do it, and we still expect him to bless us. That's problematic. If you keep trying that, you're going to have consequences from it, okay? So you might as well learn what his requirements are in his word so that you can walk in your blessing. And the other thing about these festivals I want to understand, we're to rejoice in these festivals, amen? We have more holy days, they call it holidays in our society, than the rest of everybody else. We need to learn how to operate in God's holy days, holidays, and have a joyful, blessed time and walk in his blessings and obedience to him. Yes, well, yeah, but no one else is doing that. Well, I'm sorry. God said we were peculiar people. We were set apart people. We're not supposed to look like everybody else. We're supposed to do it his way and not our way and what everybody else is doing and what other religions are doing. It's his word in his book, the way we're to do things. It's 3 times in a year, all your males shall appear before Yod-Heh-Vav, the Lord your God, in the place where he chooses, at the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and at the Feast of Weeks, and at the Feast of Booths. And they shall not appear before the Yod-Heh-Vav, the Lord, empty-handed. That's what it says. Y'all reading? Are y'all following me? I didn't make that up. It's right there. Empty-handed. And what a great time to give a sacrificial offering at this time, even though it's ending today, but we're in the midst of counting the Omer, and all, and we, you know, we're going to come to Shavuot in a few weeks, and we're going to come to Booths or Sukkot in the fall of the year. So what a time to celebrate by giving, and so we can move forward what we're doing in the community. All right, let's, I'm going to see how my time's going because I got a lot to share today. Let's go to Numbers 28. So we've just had Pesach, unleavened bread for 7 days. We're counting the Omer. In the midst of that, we had Yom Bikurim, our first fruits, when Messiah rose from the grave, and I'll talk about that in detail here in a little bit. 3 days and three nights later after his death, we're going to talk about that. So let's go to Numbers 28. Numbers 28. Verse 19. Everybody got it? And you shall present an offering by fire, a burnt offering to Yod-Heh-Vav, the Lord, 2 bulls and 1 ram and 7 male lambs, 1 year old, having them without defect. And for their grain offering, you shall offer fine flour mixed with oil, 3/10 of an ephah for a bull and 2/10 for the ram. 1/10 of an ephah you shall offer for each of the 7 lambs. And 1 male goat for a sin offering to make atonement for you. And you shall present these besides the burnt offering of the morning, which is for a continual burnt offering. After this manner, you shall present daily for 7 days the food of the offering by fire of a soothing aroma. To Yod-Heh-Vav, the Lord, it shall be presented with its libation in addition to the continual burnt offering. And on the 7th day, you shall have a holy convocation, and you shall do no laborious work. Okay, now I want to go ahead on going over to John because of time, to John chapter 6. And then I'm going to get into what I said I was going to talk about. John chapter 6. We're going to start with verse 50. You know, actually, just for the sake of understanding, let me see. I'm going to actually start at verse 41. The Jews, therefore, were grumbling about him because he said, I am the bread that came down out of heaven. Now, he's in the midst of these Jewish people 2,000 years ago over in the land of Israel, these guys, these doctors of the law, and he's telling them, I'm the true bread that came down from heaven, and they're kind of like, wait a minute, what is this all about? And they were saying, is not this Jesus, Yeshua, the son of Joseph, who was a carpenter, and he worked with his dad that they knew about, whose father and mother we know? How does he then say, I have come down out of heaven? You know, Messiah made it clear that a prophet was not honored, he was not honored mostly only in his own hometown. The people that knew him, because they knew he came to planet Earth by way, legal way and legal means of a woman, but birthed by the Holy Spirit without sin. And so they knew him, they saw him being raised up as a child around his dad, the carpenter and all that. And so they just saw him as like everybody else. And they knew he didn't go sit under the feet of Gamaliel or any of those great teachers of that day. The problem is they didn't know he was the incarnate word of God, hallelujah, that was coming down in the form of humanity, fully man and fully God. This was the problem they had. If they'd been paying attention to the scriptures that they were expounding upon clearly and paid attention and looked at the timing, they would have known better. But they were more concerned about their religious standing and their agreement with the Roman hierarchy at that time and being in the temple and all the things and benefits that they had within the hierarchy of the religious community. That was the problem they had. And Yeshua answered and said to them, do not grumble among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. That's why I said when we witness the word of God to people and God gives us an open door today, you need to do what he allows you to do. Don't try to convince somebody of something. If you got to the point you're trying to convince somebody, you just took the Holy Spirit's job away from him, and you're trying to do it, and you're going to fail miserably. You're going to do more damage than good. You wait, and you speak what God wants you to speak. Answer what they ask. Leave them hungry and thirsty for more, and if they are, they'll come back and ask you more. God will open the door. Oh, glory to God. I hope we're getting this. Too many of us are wanting to show how intelligent we are in the Word of God and how religious we are and how that if you'll just do what I say, God, boy, he'll change your life. Well, he will, but not from our own strength, from the Spirit of God's strength in us, listening to his voice, saying what he tells us to say when it's time to say it, and let the Spirit of God do his work in the people we're dealing with. Amen? Hallelujah. So, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, the Nevi'im, and they shall all be taught of Elohim of God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that any man has seen the Father except the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. That's him. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes has eternal life. And believes in the Hebrew context and setting is, I believe that Jesus, Yeshua, is the Messiah. So I'm saved. I'm cool. I'm going to heaven, right? And you go back out and you do the same things, the same sins, live the same way you lived before when you was, quote, not believing that Jesus was the Messiah. See, we have this philosophical Greek mindset that if we believe, well, yeah, I believe he's the Son of God, that we're all saved and everything's cool. And unfortunately, a lot of ways it's presented today is creating that situation. But believes is an action. It's something that we take an action. It's not a philosophical mind thing. It's something we begin to do. In other words, if we really believe he is, then we'll see what he wants us to do. If we really believe he is, then we are entering into the covenant and we don't belong to ourselves no more. We're bought with a price with the blood of Messiah. We don't belong to ourselves anymore. We belong to him. We become bondservants. We have taken the owl at the doorpost, amen, of Messiah. And we're in him and he's in us. And we don't belong to ourselves. We belong to him, and we need to walk it the way he says to walk it. Not the way we want to walk it. Not the way religion tells us to walk it. Not the way the preacher tells us to walk it. Not the way the rabbi tells us to walk it. But the way the Word of God tells us to walk it. Amen? To be like him. Hallelujah. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes has eternal life. I am. Oh, there it is. Glory to God. That's not the English words. Well, I am going to town. No, he's saying, I am. He is the I am. He told Moses, tell him, I am sent me. Hallelujah. I am the bread of life. I'm the bread of life. I'm the true bread that came down out of heaven. The bread that kept those Israelites alive for 40 years in the wilderness. Amen. Hallelujah. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread which comes down out of heaven so that one may eat it and not die. I am the living bread. He's the living bread that came down out of heaven. If anyone eats this bread, he shall live forever, eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life, eternal life. He is that bread. He is that eternal life. Hallelujah. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever, have eternal life. And the bread also which I shall give for the life of the world is my flesh. Now, let's pay attention to this because it gets interesting. Because these Jews are going to have some problems. Some of my Jewish brethren are going to have some problems with what he's fixing to say. The Jews therefore began to argue with one another, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Now, that's just about how spiritually depleted they were and how a lot of us are today. He's not really telling them, come up here and grab this arm and start eating on it. Drink that blood when it flows out. That'd go totally against Torah. And they knew the Torah taught not to eat the blood. But they're messed up. See, they're spiritually blinded and they're looking at it solely in the natural. Like it's his flesh. How are we going to do that? They're arguing about it. You talking about, you get a bunch of Jewish people together in a yeshiva that gets to arguing about something, they look like they're fighting, man. They'd be spitting on each other, trying to figure it out. Amen. The Jews therefore began to argue with one another, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Yeshua therefore said, and he said, oy, I can just see him. I cannot believe this, my brethren. Yeshua said therefore to them, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you shall have no life in yourselves. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. He said, now if you'll come up and eat some of my flesh and drink some of my blood when it comes out, well, I'll even take you up in the resurrection. Man, these guys are psyching out. You really need to think about this and put it in perspective, folks, what was going on here. They were psyching out. Because to them, this is totally against Torah. Oh, my. You ever thought about it that way? But that's not what he's talking about. He's talking about the spiritual impact here. They're not getting it. For my flesh is true food. And this is a thing like today. A lot of people, the truth is being told, but some of them are still spiritually blinded and they're not getting it. We need to pray that the Holy Spirit will open their eyes. For my flesh is true food and my blood is true drink. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me and I am in him. Glory to God. As the living Father sent me and I live because of the Father, say, he who eats me, he also shall live because of me. This is the bread which came down out of heaven, not as the fathers ate and died. He who eats this bread shall live forever, have eternal life. He who eats this bread shall live forever, have eternal life. You understand that the Word of God is the bread of God? It is the tree of life that we're eating from. Yeshua is that tree of life. He is the living Word of God. These things he said in the synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. Many, therefore, of his disciples, when they heard this, said. Now, he had a lot of followers. It's not just the 12 who were disciples or Talmudim and apostles, but he had many, many other disciples that had been made up to this point. And you know, sometimes when I teach them things the way they really are, sometimes people, they don't want to deal with it and they leave. That's not my problem. My problem will be if I don't do what God says and tell the truth, I'm going to be in trouble. So I'm going to teach the truth as God gives it to me. If I make a mistake, I'm going to come back and I'm going to tell you I made a mistake and fix it. Amen? But we're going to teach truth, and then you have to decide, do I want this truth or not, or am I going to leave? It says this, many therefore of his disciples, his Talmudim, when they heard this, said, this is a difficult statement. What's the statement about eating his blood, drinking his blood and eating his flesh? Because they didn't understand. Who can listen to this? Who can listen to this? These are the ones that were following him. They were supposed to be his disciples at this time. And now they're stumbling. But Yeshua, conscious that his disciples grumbled at this, said to them, does this cause you to stumble? What then if you should behold the Son of Man ascending where he was before? It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and are life. He's telling them. If you're stumbling over this, you need to understand the flesh is going to profit you nothing. This has to do with the spirit and it gives life. But there are some of you who do not believe. What's he really doing? There's a lot of people, oh, I believe in Yeshua. I'm following him. There's a lot of people that comes to our congregation. Some of them's been here a few days, and some of them's been here a long time, and that we think that they're following Messiah and all that and everything. And the first time things come up that's hard and difficult, we got to go through the fray, so to speak, and trust God to see us through. And it ain't suiting their fancy; they want to leave. It's God's way of pruning the tree. We don't want to see nobody lost and leaving, neither does God. He came into the world that all would be saved. But the reality of it is, and he knows and we know, that there's some, when it gets down to really worshiping him and following him with our whole heart and making a commitment to God, it requires a commitment to follow him. And the body here requires a commitment. That some people do this. That's too hard. That's too hard. And reality, following God is hard. He said, listen, birds have nests and the foxes have holes, but the Son of Man has not where to lay his head. The gift of salvation is a free gift. It's only attained through the sacrifice of Messiah. He's done provided it for anybody and everybody, whosoever will. But if we're going to accept that free gift, we need to count the cost if we're going to follow him. It means giving up our identity. In America, we don't want to give up our identity to follow anybody. It's all about us. Or we'll give up a little bit of it as long as it feels good, as long as I like the way it's going. But let me tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. We don't belong to ourselves no more. If we're really in covenant, we have to give up our whole identity. We belong to Him. Hallelujah. And we need to put aside our petty differences, because they ain't about us no more. It's about Him. Amen? Hallelujah. It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But there are some of you who do not believe. In other words, the reality is, when it comes down to it, did they really believe? Some of them didn't, and He knew it. There's some who say they do, following the whole time, and that they really don't. Because there was those who was with us, but they really weren't of us, because they left us. If they'd have been with us, they'd have still been here. Amen. I'm paraphrasing that. But these are some of you who do not believe, for Yeshua knew from the beginning who they were who did not believe, because He was the Son of God. He knows all things. He was God incarnate. He knew who they were from the beginning. When they first come there, they really didn't believe. They were playing the game. They were being religious. And He also knew who it was that would betray Him. And He was saying, for this reason I have said to you that no one can come to me unless it has been granted him of the Father. As a result of this, many of His disciples withdrew. The ones who really didn't believe that was being His disciples, they withdrew. And were not walking with Him anymore. Jesus said, therefore, to the 12, you do not want to go away also, do you? The 12, the special ones, the closest to Him, with Him every day. Simon Peter answered Him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And we have believed and have come to know that You are the Holy One, the Kadosh One of Elohim of God. Yeshua Jesus answered them, did I myself not choose you, the 12, and yet one of you is a devil? Now He meant Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, for he, one of the 12, was going to betray Him. Hallelujah. Sad but true. One, that the Scriptures might be fulfilled. It's always sad. It's always sad when you think someone's fallen Messiah, and when it doesn't go my way or their way or whatever. If you know, when things don't go my way, if I walk out the door and walk away from Messiah, then I really wasn't following Him. If things don't go your way and you do it, you really won't follow Him. You was just being really religious. You might even know how to quote. You might have a photographic memory and know how to quote Genesis to Revelation. But if you're really following Him, you're not letting nothing stop you from following Him. Not anything. You're going to follow Him, and you're going to take the good with the bad, and you're going to trust Him because He's in control of everything. Listen, He put me here and He can take me away. He put you here and He can take you away. We're in His hands, glory to God. He is the one to whom we look to. He is the one that's in control, not you and I. We know that the feast had its fulfillment in the resurrection of Messiah, Yeshua. It is written in 1 Corinthians 15, 3-4, for I delivered to you as the first importance, which I also received, that the Messiah died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. Now, there are seven pillars of Paul or Shaul's theology. And as we study his letters, we must apply this information. If we do not, we are taking Scripture out of its context to make it fit a doctrine that cannot be proven in the Bible. And this is the problem with a lot of people that's done this. Number one, Paul was a Pharisee. No question about it, he was a Pharisee. He never changed from one religion to another. He never did that. He never quit being a Jew Pharisee and became a Christian, so to speak. First of all, that did not exist at that time. That's a modern terminology, okay? The word ecclesia, from where we get church, from where we get Christians in churches, it's actually the congregation, the assembly of the believers. The Jewish and the non-Jewish, the Gentiles alike, who went into covenant with Messiah. That was the biblical scriptural religion of the followers of Messiah. Number two, Paul's view of the Torah was always, listen to me, always positive. He told Felix when he stood before the governor, Felix, and there were Jewish people were accusing him, wanting to get him in trouble with the law, and he was denying their charges, and he said, listen, but there's one thing that I will admit, according to the Derek in Hebrew, the way. I believe everything that is written in the Torah, the law, and in the Vim, the prophets. That was a statement in the book of Acts that Paul made. So you either got to assume from that he's a liar, a deceiver, from one time to the next, or he meant what he said. And I am fully convinced, as I have studied in context, that he was always a positive believer in God's word, the Torah. Number three, Paul's calling mission was, of course, always to the Jew first, but it was a main mission of this particular apostle, disciple, to the Gentiles as well. Yet he remained an Orthodox Jew. I believe from what I understand and study that he was on the Sanhedrin till the day he died. Yes, they wanted to kill him for his faith in Messiah, but they had no Torah reason for being able to dismiss him from the position that he held. If you find something that disagrees with that, please let me know and I'll retract that statement. Paul, I believe, remained a part of the Sanhedrin as a Pharisee. He remained as a Pharisee till the day he died. They really had no reason to dismiss him Torah-wise, even though he would believe that Yeshua, Jesus, was the Messiah, and they didn't like it. They preferred him to be dead and tried to have him killed. That's my belief on it. Find something different, please let me know, and I'll fix that. That's what I've found out so far. Number four, love must characterize the believer's life of ministry to others. Number five, the grace of God is revealed through Yeshua, Jesus, the Mashiach, the Messiah. Number six, the resurrection of Yeshua is the first fruit of the general resurrection. We'll talk about that. The first to ever be raised from the dead, to never die again, showing us that he has the power over death for our resurrection in the time to come. Number seven, amen. Yeshua is coming again to complete the work of redemption. He has started the work of redemption. He has betrothed himself to us who are in covenant with him, the bride of Messiah, who have been redeemed from our sinfulness to be a bride. Preparing a bride to, and that's what we have on our slogan here, that Am Israel, the people of Israel, Am Israel Messianic Synagogue is Hebrew for the people of Israel in Messiah. And that's really who we are. And this is the meeting place, the synagogue where we meet. And so that's who we are. And we are the bride, and we are preparing the bride to meet the Messiah. Yes. There's too many people not preparing even to make disciples, let alone for them to be have the understanding of that they're the bride of Messiah and what it means to be a bride. He is not coming back for just any bride, folks. Let me tell you, it's a bride without spot, without wrinkle, and without blemish. That's the word of God. So he's coming again to complete the work of redemption. All must be prepared for the day of judgment. Judgment, mishpatim is the Hebrew word. Judgment is coming to planet Earth. Because while God is a great God of awesome love so much that he was willing to be beat, stuck with a spear, whipped in his back, nails through his hands, his blood shed to die for our redemption, and he did that so that everybody could come to faith, yet there will be a time when he has to bring, being a righteous God, has to bring judgment. Everybody will have their day in court. Everybody who's ever been born will be stand at one time or another in one resurrection or another before the judgment seat of Messiah or the white throne judgment seat after the millennial reign. Everybody will have their day in court. According to 1 Corinthians 15, 13 through 19, if there is no resurrection from the dead, you will take seven steps downward. And these are what they would be. Number one, the Messiah is not risen. Number two, our preaching is in vain and we are wasting our time. Number three, we are declared liars. Number four, your faith is worthless. Number five, you are still in your sins. Number six, those who have died in Messiah have perished. And number seven, we who are alive are to be pitied. That's what Paul said. What does this mean? The resurrection of Messiah is simply this. The resurrection Messiah means that Messiah is the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, and the Declaration of Independence of the Messianic faith. Oh, glory to God. You understand that? Let me say it again. What does it mean? That the resurrection of Messiah is the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, the Declaration of Independence of the Messianic faith. If a person denies the resurrection, he is forced into six horrible conclusions. Six horrible conclusions if he denies that he rose from the dead. Number one, all preaching has been, is now, and always will be utterly and completely useless. If you deny. Number two, all past, present, and future faith is futile. Number three, all preachers become notorious and rabbis become notorious liars. Number four, all living believers are still in their sins. Number five, all departed believers are in hell. And number six, all reasons and purposes for life itself is destroyed without the resurrection. And all us claiming that there is a resurrection and that we're in Messiah. But the fact is, there is a resurrection. Amen. The fact simply is there is truly a resurrection. Because of a misunderstanding of Roman procedure, the church places the denial of Peter at about 5:30 to 6 o'clock a.m. based on this scripture in Matthew 26, 34, which reads, Yeshua said unto him, Verily I say unto thee that this night before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me thrice. They interpreted the words cock crow as two words, to be the sound of a rooster. That was problematic. The problem is with the time travel and the different activities that Yeshua experienced before the cross cannot be covered within that time frame. And consider this single word, cock crow. The various accounts of the denial of Peter three times before the cock crow, not cock crow, two words, cock row differ a little bit. And you can take this wherever you want to take it, check this on your own, but this is an interesting thing I wanted to put in here. But the setting is vivid. The country and the palace of the high priest at 3 o'clock in the morning, which was the time of the trumpet call for the Roman changing of the guard ringing out through Jerusalem, was called, listen to this, cock row. That's what it was called. That makes a little bit more sense when you put that in perspective. Now, there was this scripture, and there was this issue that came up with these people, these great theologians of that day, and these Jewish people that were there who didn't believe that Yeshua was the Messiah, and they said, listen. He said, look, if you're really the Messiah, just give us a sign and we'll believe you. That's what he said. How are we going to know you're the Messiah? Give us a sign. It is written in Matthew 12, 39 and 40, he answered, a wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, but I'm not going to give you a sign except for the sign of the prophet Jonah. For just as Jonah was in the belly of the whale 3 days and three nights, so shall the Son of Man be in the heart of the earth 3 days and three nights. This is the only sign Messiah was going to give them because he wasn't going to play along with their game. I'm telling you, this is how it's going to be, ladies and gentlemen. Just as the sign of the prophet Jonah, so shall be that you will know that I am the Messiah, that I am God in the flesh. 3 days and three nights, I'm going to be in the heart of the earth. The 3 days and three nights in Jonah 1:17 refer to a 72-hour period. Now consider this. One night and one day equals 24 hours. Each day for the Jew starts at sundown. Go back to Genesis if you don't believe it. And ends at sundown. All through the Bible it makes that clear. 24 hours later. Two nights and 2 days are equal to 48 hours. Three nights and 3 days equal 72 hours. You may think, why are you being so precise? Because God's word is precise. And the reason we got the problems we got is because we hadn't followed God's precise word. We've done our own thing. Catholicism has made its own rules and regulations up, called the catechisms. In place of the Word of God, they have both. But they teach for the most part, from the catechism, they used to forbid anyone to have an actual scripture in their hands. Way on back, it threat of death. You didn't get caught with it. So that way they could teach you what they wanted you to believe. Judaism has some books too that have a lot of good things in it, but they've got some bad things that's outside of scripture. So does the Book of Mormon. The Mormons have the Bible, but what else do they have? The Book of Mormon. And when you talk to a Mormon, they're going to want to be talking to you from the Book of Mormon way more than the Bible. This is where these are called the traditions of men, which have made the Word of God of none effect. That's what it boils down to. Matthew 27:63, Mark 8:31, Mark 9:31, Mark 10:24, Luke 24:7, and John 2:19-21 also confirm the duration. To reject this singular proof is to reject the only sign that Yeshua himself gave for his being the Mashiach, the Messiah. Now, another question. How can Yeshua be crucified and die at 3 o'clock p.m. on Good Friday, rise on Sunday, and fulfill this verse? He cannot. You can do the math. You ask any child that can count to 10, and they can tell you, because they're not inundated with all the false garbage. They can tell you real quick. And that's what always tickles me. Pastor, how in the world? You said he was in the grave 3 days and three nights. Well, then how in the world? Pulling on his, get away, son, get away. But Friday to Sunday's not 3 o'clock. No, go back to your mama. You don't think that's happened? This happened more than once. He cannot. Let's take a deeper look at the 3 days. The 3 days. And here's where I want you to take notes and pay close attention. Some of you already know this. When the Council of Nicaea, we use the word church, rejected the feast and redefined Easter because they set up the church as the first Sunday after the spring equinox, they also redefined the Word of God to fit their doctrine and went into error. Take a look at these 3 days when connected to feasts. All right, here it comes. Day number one, the Pesach of the Passover / unleavened bread. It is written in John 19:31, then the Jews, because it was the day of preparation. This comes from John 19:31. You want to look at this. Then the Jews, because it was the day of preparation so that the bodies would not remain on the cross or the execution stake, whatever you want to call it, on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath was a high day. There is a definite defining of this particular Sabbath. So they asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. This Sabbath happened to be a high day that was coming up as they were executed. As he was executed, they was coming to the end of the day, and a new day was going to start at sundown. That was Nisan the 14th. It would have been Nisan the 15th. They had to have them off of the cross. That was Jewish law. And the Romans respected that. There were some things they respected, so they had to have them off. The high day Sabbath is never connected to the weekly Sabbath. It's never connected, except for when it points, this is the beginning of your Sabbath, the weekly Sabbath, and then the high Sabbath, the Moedim, the Pesach, the unleavened bread, the Yom Bikurim, Shavuot. So let me read it again. The high Sabbath is never connected to the weekly Sabbath. It is connected to one of the annual holy days in Leviticus 23. It is written in Leviticus 23:5 that Yodivathe's Passover begins at twilight on the 14th day of the first month. This verse places the Passover at the start of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. The Feast of Unleavened Bread, it is written in Leviticus 23:6-7. On the 15th day of the month, Yodivathe's Feast of Unleavened Bread begins. For 7 days you must eat bread made without yeast. On the first day, hold a sacred assembly and do no regular work. This covers the time from Wednesday night to Thursday night, 1 day. Wednesday night to Thursday night, 1 day. Day two, preparation day for weekly Sabbath. The women prepared spices and perfumes for the weekly Sabbath, because we must remember There are two Sabbaths in this week. And this is where most have missed it. There's the high Sabbath and the regular weekly Sabbath. And there's a day in between that the ladies can do something. Okay, they can't work on the high Sabbath. They can do some things the next day, and they can't work on the regular Sabbath. So the women prepared the spices and perfumes for the weekly Sabbath. It is written in Luke 23:56, then they returned and prepared spices and perfumes. And on the Sabbath day they rested according to the commandment. They believed the commandments. They rested. This verse was before the weekly Sabbath. Look it up. This covers the time from Thursday night to Friday night, day two. Thursday night to Friday night, day two. It is written in Mark 16:1, when the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might come and anoint him. And this verse was after the weekly Sabbath that they came. They had prepared it already that day, had to wait till the weekly Sabbath was over, and then they were going to come and bring and anoint him with them. Remember, they didn't have the time to do any of this to start off with, because they had the rush to even get him in the tomb on time before the high Sabbath started. Day three, the weekly Sabbath. It is written in Leviticus 23:2-3. Speak to the Israelites and say to them, these are my appointed feast, the appointed feast of Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the Lord, which you are to proclaim as a sacred assembly, or assemblies. There are 6 days when you may work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of rest, a day of a sacred assembly. The first of the feast is the regular weekly, every day, every week Sabbath. You are not to do any work wherever you live. It is a Sabbath to Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the Lord. This covers the time from Friday night to Saturday night, the weekly Sabbath, and the 72 hours from the crucifixion. This is when Yeshua rose from the dead, day three. Day four, that's been referred to as Easter Sunday, which is technically the first day of the week, or even on our Gregorian calendar, always has been. It is written in Matthew 28:1, Now after the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave. This is halfway through Sunday of day four. Consider this. Mark 16:9 is the sole basis. It's the only basis for the idea that Messiah rose on the first day. It is written in Mark 18:9. Now after he had risen, listen to these words carefully. Now after he had risen early on the first day of the week, he appeared to Mary Magdalene, from whom he had cast out 7 demons. Let's read it a little more carefully. It doesn't say he did rise. It says, or rose on the third day. It says he had arisen. He had arisen. And this is the past perfect tense, meaning that the grave was empty at that time. He had already risen. And that's the only basis they have from any of the Gospels to try to make it say otherwise. And all you got to do is change the apostrophe when they do the translations from one place to the other to make it say something different. Is this scripture describing when Yeshua rose or when he appeared to Mary? Punctuation was added later. I just talked about it a little bit. And subject to error. Translators placed commas wherever they thought they should go based on their belief. By placing the comma after week connects the resurrection to the first day of the week. By placing the comma after risen, it connects it to the appearance of Mary. Easter is mentioned only once in the King James Version of the Bible. And I'm going to say this. It is a bad translation. Now, I had this discussion with a certain person who is a King James person only, and there's this whole teaching, you go on the internet and look at it, how they explain away how that was really a correct rendering, because that Herod at that time was keeping Peter in jail in Acts until, and the claim here is that he was a worshiper of Easter. He called it Easter, not Passover. If you follow the whole teaching through and follow the scripture, it's a big bunch of baloney. I'm telling you right now, do your own work. Don't take my word for it. It's a big bunch of baloney they're using to justify the error in that King James Version. The King James is one of the greatest translations there is in the world. I'll be first to admit it. But it has a few wrong things in it. Let's just get real about it. Okay? So, and here's the other thing. I'm going to give it to you in just a minute. Easter is mentioned again, like I said, that one time. It's actually written in Acts 12:4, if you want to take a note. And when King Herod had apprehended him, Peter, he put him in prison and delivered him to four quaternions of squads of soldiers to keep him. Intending after, that's where they insert the word Easter. But in the Greek that they translate it from, and they translate it from the Textus Receptus, the Greek of the Textus Receptus, is Pascha. It's always been Pascha. And they're trying to take this one time where they made an error of 29 times, they're trying to say it, and they agree all of the 28 times that the same Greek word Pascha is representing Passover, but here it really means Easter. And it's really, you know, and then they're trying to go on through there and try to say it's not pagan. Well, then if it's not pagan, why are they having a problem with King Herod keeping a different day? See, when you don't keep it straight as you go along, it all falls down on you at some point. And that's the problem. So the Greek word is Pascha, goes to the Hebrew word Pesach, or Passover, to bring forth the people. As mentioned before, the resurrection of the Messiah is the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, the Declaration of Independence, of the Messianic faith. Everything connects to the resurrection of the Messiah. Everything connects to the resurrection of the Messiah. Everything we do is about Messiah from the dead. That is why Paul had to ask the Corinthian believers why they were saying there was no resurrection. Because if Yeshua had not risen from the dead, we are all men most pitied, most miserable. Paul had to deal with this too within the Corinthian congregation. You don't think we're going to have to deal with it? It's been being dealt with since Messiah's death and resurrection. This is the enemy's trap, his deceitfulness. We always have to be prepared to give an account of the hope that's within us. We need to know what the Word of God says so we can show them. When people ask about this, leave all your opinions out of it. Say, well, look, my opinion doesn't matter. Let's go. Let me show you what the Word says about it. Deal with it from the Word of God. Everything, the challenge of the resurrection. Let's talk about that for a minute. Let's do a little challenge of the resurrection. Has anyone ever challenged you by saying, prove to me that Yeshua rose from the dead scientifically? I'm thinking about you, Sister Donna. Scientifically. And I will believe. What would you do? There's those out there that's being challenged with that. Some of you in here have been challenged with that. Here's the reality of it. The problem with this statement is that you cannot prove any event scientifically. Think about it for a moment. You cannot prove any event scientifically. Hitler cannot be proven that he existed scientifically, but you can prove he existed legally and or historically. You can also prove that Yeshua rose from the dead legally and or historically. Over 24,630 manuscripts can back the historical proof of the resurrection. Let me say that again. 24,630 manuscripts can back the proof of it. The legal process has a different structure, though. There are three types of legal proof of evidence accepted in a court of law. You know, our God is a God of law, a God of justice as mercy. He's all about justice. He's all about everything being done. You know, he can't lie. Everything he does is going to be perfect. If we're not understanding something, he's not the problem, we are. We just don't understand yet. We need to do some more praying and studying. It's us, not him. Everything he has is in perfect order. The legal process with these three types of evidence that can be accepted in the court of law are, number one, written exhibits, number two, oral exhibits, and number three, testimonies. This can be done concerning the resurrection. In solving the legal proof, a principle must be understood. You must be dead, Number one, to be resurrected. You got to be dead to be resurrected. Two major security precautions were done to make sure that that happened. The first, and you're going to find this interesting, the first security precaution was its preparation and death by crucifixion. The Roman soldiers would give a beating before they executed a person. This is all historically proven. It's all written down. It's documented. The whip would rip through the skin, showing muscle and bone. People have died receiving this beating. Then came the crown of thorns pushed down and beaten on his head so that the crown would stay. When a person was crucified, it was not rope that held him to the cross, but nails. And I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to share in the upcoming months, I'm working on it now, from the old picture graphic Paleo-Hebrew to the modern Hebrew, how all this shows the picture of all this. From a picture point of view, it's going to shock you. The last precaution for his death was the four Roman executioners guarding the cross so that no one could remove the body before it had died. Four of them. If this happened before death, the Roman soldiers took the person's place on the cross. You men who are in the military know how serious it is to violate an order. And back then, they was real serious about it. This is why Yeshua was stabbed in the side by a spear. It was the final act of assurance that he was dead. What does this mean? Yeshua did not come off the cross until he was dead. The second security precaution was the solid rock tomb that he was placed in. The first thing facing the tomb was the very large stone. According to ancient writings, this stone weighed between 1.5 to 2 tons. Once sealed, it would have been almost impossible to remove. The second thing was the seal of Caesar attached to the tomb. If anyone broke that seal, all the authority of the Roman Empire would descend upon that person and their family. There's consequences for your family if you disobeyed as a soldier. The fear of Rome would have prevented anyone from breaking the seal. The third thing at the tomb was the Roman security guard, consisting of 16 combat-trained soldiers. That's right, 16. These men were trained to attack or defend 6 feet of ground. That's how they were trained. They were very good at what they did. On the night watch, 4 men would guard the tomb while the 12 men slept. These 12 men would have slept with their backs to the tomb, facing outward, so if attacked, they could rise up facing the enemy. Anyone trying to steal the body would be facing these men. I don't think those disciples were capable of facing those men. These precautions proved one thing. Yeshua was graveyard dead at that time. I don't care what all this nonsense is they're teaching here today. It's a fact he was graveyard dead. And the Word of God says so. Facts to be considered. Again, I repeat the challenge. Prove to me that Yeshua rose from the dead. For a person not to believe in the resurrection, he must explain away 6 major facts. The first fact deals with the 1.5 to 2 ton stone blocking the entrance being moved. Who moved the stone? Who did it? Was it his disciples? I believe the answer is no. They were in fear of the Roman government themselves. They all ran, remember? They thought they would be next. If that were not the case, then there would have been no reason for their doors being locked when Yeshua appeared to them. They were hidden from the hiding from the government with their doors locked. Y'all remember that? Was it the next one? Was it the Jewish leadership? How about the Jewish leadership? I say again, the answer is no, because they were the ones who got Pilate to set up the guard at the tomb to begin with. They also would have not broken the seal of Rome, knowing that that would happen to them. What would happen to the soldiers? So then who moved the stone? The second fact involves the Roman guard going AWOL. We all know AWOL. They were protecting the seal of Caesar. To go AWOL on this watch meant a certain painful death for them and their families. Why did the Roman soldiers go AWOL? The third fact is the grave clothes. It is written in John 20:6-8, and so Simon Peter also came following him and entered the tomb. And he saw the linen wrappings laying there, and the face cloth which had been on his head not laying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. So the other disciple who had first come to the tomb then also entered, and he saw and believed. John was the other disciple. Why did John believe? John saw that the removal of the body was not done in haste. This time was taken to separate and fold the face cloth. Someone who was not in a hurry to exit the tomb would have done this. The fourth fact is eyewitnesses. This is interesting. It is recorded that at one point in 1 Corinthians 5:16, over 500 people saw the resurrected Messiah. That works out to be over 50 hours of testimony, allowing 6 minutes for each person. Later, many of them would pay with their lives because of their testimony. Would you die for a lie knowing it was a lie? Would these guys die, and would you die later on after you saw that he was... Listen, they would have never... They all ran to start off with. But now they know. They saw him dead and buried. And they, now they... Listen, you got something you can believe in now. He's resurrected. You're willing to lay your life down. You must also consider the character of the witnesses. Some, like Thomas and Jacob, James, Yeshua's half-brother, were unconvinced at that time. They would later die for their testimony. Did you know his brothers, physical half-brothers, if you want to say that, didn't believe in him until his resurrection? But they was willing to die later on for him. Every single apostle, with the exception of John, ended up laying their life down for their faith in Messiah later on. Before that, they all ran. Some were hostile, like Shaul, who would later become called Paul. He killed the followers of Yeshua, yet after meeting the resurrected Messiah, he changed his character, his relationship with God and men, his message, and his mission. 4 times he suffered 39 stripes of the whip, imprisoned, chained in irons in a Roman guard for at least 2 years, shipwrecked, and death because of his testimony. Why would he go through this if the resurrection were a hoax? Why would he? He was there when the first martyr took place with Stephen holding his cloak, and they were stoning him to death. He had letters to persecute the believers in Damascus in the synagogues who believed in Messiah when he met Messiah on the Damascus road that changed his life forever. And after all that, after his change and his meeting the Mashiach, he spent his whole life changed man because of the resurrection of Messiah. A changed man. And he died with his head, according to tradition, laid on Nero's chopping block for the cause of the good news of the gospel of Yeshua the Messiah. The fifth fact is that a woman saw him first. If the resurrection were a hoax, this would not have happened. Why? Because in that society, a woman was not a legal witness. Her testimony, as it was, is rejected immediately. This is why Peter and John checked it out themselves. A lot of things we can learn when we understand the society and what the laws are and what's happening. We got to get back to what's really taking place. They became the two witnesses required by the Torah. And the sixth fact is the empty tomb. The resurrection started in Jerusalem, the place of the crucifixion, and not from the outskirts of the Roman Empire. If the resurrection was a hoax, all the Jewish and Roman authorities had to do to kill the lie was to produce the body. This messianic movement would have died in that moment. They did not produce the body because they could not. Both the messianic believers and the non-messianic believers believed that the tomb was empty. The question is, can anyone prove that it was not? There's a lot more I'd like to share, but I can't because of time. But I'll end up with this. There is one man in Scripture that understood the substitution process of Messiah, and that was Barabbas. And why did he understand it? Number one, he knew he was a justly condemned sinner. Number two, he knew Yeshua was an innocent sufferer. Number three, he knew the innocent sufferer had taken his place. Number four, he knew he had done nothing to merit this substitution. Number five, he also knew that Yeshua's substitution in his place satisfied the law. And I mean the law of the land at that time within the government. Do we have the same knowledge as Barabbas had today? We have the power to vote, and we have three choices. Choose one of the following. Number one, do you not believe in the resurrection? And that is your vote. Number two, you are not prepared to vote, but by not voting, you have already made your choice. That's the lukewarm, according to the scripture. To the congregation of those who are lukewarm in Revelation, he said, because of that, you've already made, I'll spew you out of my mouth. Number three, you do believe in the resurrection and vote. If this is your choice, your vote will change your life and your walk. You cannot do this vote and not change. You have to change if you vote in the affirmative. Do not take this vote lightly. Here's why. I, you, and God will stand by your vote. Today the decision is ours. It's yours. Thank God, then consider, what will you do with Yeshua? What will we do with Yeshua? Someday the choice will be his. Today it's ours. But someday the choice is going to be his in judgment. Then the question will be, what will he do with you? What will he do with me? We can raise our hands, showing our choice, but the real vote is in our heart, and God sees it. I might not can see your heart, but God sees it. It is written in John 12:32, and if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me. May God truly bless you. And I trust if you have had any questions about this, that this has answered them. If you're not where you need to be with Messiah, today is a day of salvation for anyone who calls upon his name. If you need to talk to me after the service today and pray with you, I'll be glad to do so. Let's all stand. Abba, Father, I praise you. I thank you. I've tried to do the best that I could today to speak your word and your truth, Father. I pray that it has penetrated deep within people's hearts and minds. Those who were not sure, I pray that today there's assurance and clarity in their hearts. I pray if there's anyone here today that has not truly committed their life, their soul, their whole being to you, that today will be that day, for the day is a day of salvation. Abba, I just ask you to move in every person's life, meet every need. Father, for we know that you are a redeemer, you are a healer, our deliverer, you are all in all, and we give you all glory and all honor, and we thank you so much for coming and paying the price that we couldn't pay for us, Father. There's no way we can thank you enough. There's not any amount of good deeds we can do to pay you back. But you loved us so much. And by your grace and mercy, you came and died for us. And we're just so grateful to you, Father. Help us to be faithful and true to you in all that we do. Help us to be a pure bride without spot, wrinkle, or blemish, waiting on your soon returning, Father, for your bride and setting the things right on planet earth. And we give you glory and honor in the name of Yeshua the Messiah. Amen.